Clara, you seem to be muted.
Thank you, Mark. I was apologizing to all of you for starting this late. I had a local connectivity issue, so had to get on the hotspot. But we are here and ready to go, so apologies to everyone for the delay. Who of the of our trainers, who do you want me to switch it to?
I think I'm up first with A to J.
Okay. Okay, and I'm gonna make you an organizer. So you have full control. Okay, organize. I'm gonna make everybody an organizer. Okay, so you're organizer now, Jessica.
Okay, thanks. So this is Jessica Frank, and I'm A to J Author's project manager. For today's, the beginning of today's class, the homework was to watch the basics of document assembly, how A to J Author and HotDocs fit together, and then a 30-minute intro video on A to J Author. So I can go through the software, I can answer any questions. It's kind of up to all of you on what you want to talk about. So feel free to raise your hand and we can unmute you or put your questions in the chat box and we can do that as well. There isn't any A to J Author homework until we start the last two sessions of this 8-week class. We'll have some sample exercises that I built that will walk you through automating a document in A to J. So there's really nothing that you had to do for our side of it until you get to week 6 of that one. So if you don't have any homework or you don't have any questions about A to J, I can always turn it over to Mark and Bart to talk about HotDocs PDFs. I'm not seeing any questions. Oh, there's Emily with a question.
Emily, yes.
Oh, they're still muted. Okay, let me, I'm gonna unmute everyone. So other organizers, I'm gonna hit the button here to unmute everyone. All right, everyone should be unmuted and then you're just self-muted. So go ahead, Emily.
Hi, it was good to see the demonstration and the new, looks like, you know, there's been a lot of updates too, which they all looked good. I was just wondering, it seems like the sort of the theory behind the A to J is, you know, that it's sort of friendlier or easier for users, I guess, than just kind of the basic sort of hot docs, just putting the questions up there. And I just wondered if there was, if you had gotten sort of data or feedback to kind of show that that is the case and that it, that users do find that sort of avatar presentation helpful.
Yeah, so originally A to J was developed in 2005 as a front end for HotDocs because user testing had shown that the HotDocs interface was still pretty complicated for self-represented litigants, sort of in that fifth to seventh grade reading level. And so we were initially designed to be a replacement for the HotDocs interview, to keep the HotDocs backend template and have an A to J interview. And we've been run now 7 million times since 2005. So we have the data of usage in terms of how many people are running through guided interviews. We expanded in 2016 to include our own backend template. So as a replacement for some things that HotDocs can do, we now have the A to J DAT, which is our document assembly tool. So you can have a complete document assembly experience for your end users from the interview all the way through the template creation. And part of what A to J has that can sometimes be lacking in HotDocs interviews is the mobile friendly. So we've been mobile friendly for 8 years now since A to J 5 was released. And we've done a lot of work on accessibility. So we had an independent accessibility audit 4 years ago and have spent the last 4 years working through TIG grants to improve accessibility, to make it as high as possible for the WCAG standards. And a lot of our stuff is AA or AAA compliant with WCAG, which is the AAA is the highest level of accessibility standards for web content accessibility guidelines, the WCAG, WCAG standards. And so a lot of work has gone into making this as a robust experience for self-represented litigants as possible. We also have pop-ups and learn mores, and you can have videos and graphics and extra text at the point in which the end user needs it, which is more unique to A2J Author than to other front-end interfaces. So there we have data on the conversion rate between interviews that have A2J as a front-end and have hot docs in terms of how many get assembled. It can pull some of those if you're interested from the LHI statistics that are run each quarter. But yeah, so it has shown over the past almost decade that A2J is generally a more friendly interface for self-represented litigants, and hot docs is generally a more friendly interface for advocates or people who are more experienced with using technology.
Okay, thanks. It's interesting also to hear you explain the sort of history, because I was wondering about that too, about how the two kind of fit together over the years.
Yeah, we've had a long marriage with A2J and hot docs on LHI, and a lot of co-development, all TIG funded for the most part, with LHI and A2J working together. And so everything we share on A2J, which we went open source in 2020, but so everything is available. We work closely with the LHI team to push everything that that we roll out onto the LHI environment as well. And you'll learn more about A2J and the different enhancements that you can add to an interview in the later videos and in the sample exercises. And then on those last two classes, I don't have videos on them, but I'll talk a lot about our accessibility work that we did in the last year, really heavily focused on our interviews about language access. We currently support 16 additional languages in A2J, training resources and stuff to get you going that that will help you in authoring your interviews. Anyone else have any questions? Okay, well, I think I can turn it then over to the Capstone team to talk about HotDocs PDF automation.
Cool, thank you, Jessica. This is Mark. I think I'll lead this discussion about the HotDocs side of this week. But to emphasize Jessica's points, we now at LHI and through A2J Author and A2J.org offer a variety of approaches for providing interactive interviews and document assembly to both self-represented litigants and advocates and court staff. So you get a lot of choices. It's sometimes a complex decision. You're balancing the modernity and the flexibility of the and the accessibility of the A2J experience against, in some ways, the power and the complexity handling capability of HotDocs. And depending upon the nature of the template you're working on or the application you have in mind, you may find yourself strongly pushed in one direction or the other, or you may find yourself kind of seeing them evenly balanced and just having to make a choice. One interesting twist is you can have the same template render itself both as an A2J front end for self-represented litigants and as a HotDocs interview for advocates. So you can have kind of a double-headed template that sometimes makes sense for people when you're serving both kinds of audiences. We're happy to answer more questions about that decision. Let me just quickly turn to the other half of this week, which is a very brief introduction to HotDocs PDF automation. Again, this is one place where I think HotDocs really shines in terms of its power and programmability. You can create quite complex suites of PDF templates that are nicely engineered to handle almost any imaginable set of user inputs. But let me open it up for questions. Did people have success in going through the few simple steps of doing a PDF template in HotDocs? Any questions, reactions to that experience? And I think you're all unmuted centrally. You can unmute yourself locally, or you can raise your hand. And my fellow organizers, let me know if you see any questions that I am missing. There are a lot of commonalities between automating templates in Hotdocs in Word and automating them in PDF, but PDF does present some special interesting challenges because you're dealing with a fixed substrate of a graphical template, and you're kind of limited to working on the surface and adding things on the surface. You can't automate the underlying static form in its behavior.
I like PDF automation better though, because it is static and you're constrained to a certain amount of area. Right. So you don't have to worry about the formatting or an end user's answer going crazy. Like, you can limit their characters, you can constrain them a bit. So my like thinking inside the box personality appreciates the PDFs better. I find it easier to do the PDFs too.
Yeah, I lean that way, and of course many court forms and other government agency forms are PDFs from the get-go. Okay, I've got to run. I'm sorry, Bart. Can you take over?
I was muted, so. I'm here to respond if folks have questions about PDF. Can everybody hear me?
We can, Bart.
Okay.
I guess a sort of philosophical question, this is Emily again, around when you are doing PDFs, about sort of like how much flexibility to allow. In some cases it may be that the form is specific enough that you kind of know the universe of potential answers, or you think you do, but if it's a more general form where it's like, you know, theoretically someone could maybe want to fill in a bunch of extra parties and they could theoretically do that, how do you think about sort of whether to kind of build that in with overflow, or to just kind of program for the more run of the mill, sort of for the most use, you know, how do you think about, I guess, programming for sort of most users versus programming for sort of the edge cases?
Well, you know, I think you want to try and build in as much flexibility as you can reasonably expect people to need. There are some ways of doing that, and you know, typically what you will encounter with PDF templates is that the forms you're working with are fairly limited. You know, so you will have a form, family law form, that says, you know, enter the names of your children, and it'll have four spaces for children. And you know, there are people who have more than four children, and in the real world, you know, the non-automated world, what the court typically expects is that you will attach a document that says, you know, I also have three other children, here are their names. There are, with PDF templates, there are a variety of ways that you can sort of automatically attach the, you know, additional sheets. There's a built-in capability of overflow, and you can also do custom overflows where you essentially add logic that says, if there are more than four kids, then add this other page with the, you know, the other kids' names on it. So there's, you can automate it with a good deal of flexibility. You know, I'd have to see specific examples, and you know, I mean, typically what I find is that the forms themselves have tremendous limitations, and sometimes, you know, they'll ask for a narrative and they won't give enough space for the narrative, and then you have to accommodate that by an attachment somehow. And as I said, there's a couple of different ways of doing it. The sort of built-in overflow capabilities that exist in Hotdocs PDF templates have some drawbacks. The building sort of a custom overflow also has, you know, some limitations, and it also takes a lot more work. But there are ways of sort of customizing the forms, if you will, by adding additional sheets.
I play the, just playing the devil's advocate here, I look at it more on the other side in terms of scoping. So in terms of like triaging, right? You go into an emergency room and the nurse at the front counter has to decide, you know, does this person, can they stitch themselves up? Are they going to need a nurse practitioner? Do they need to go into surgery immediately or need a lot of additional help? And so when I do forms development and I see restrictions on the PDF template in terms of like how much can fit like four children, sometimes instead of, and you don't have to then deal with custom overflows and that kind of stuff, is you limit the interview to the form, right? So it'll, if there are spaces for four children, then in the interview you set that up in the beginning. You explain to the end user that this automated form is only intended for people who have four children, or who have children all have the same biological parent, or who live in this jurisdiction, or have this amount of money, or have, you know, this many assets, or like whatever your limiter is at the beginning. If you're going to restrict it, let people know right off the bat. And that sort of takes that triage that the people who have this relatively straightforward cases, and that they maybe only have four children, or they have the same biological parents, or whatever the limiting instance is, you can triage them out of the flow maybe of legal aid or the self-help center, and have them go on to the DIY path. And those who have more complicated situations should maybe document assembly isn't right for them, and they should be going and finding additional resources elsewhere if that's possible. So it sort of depends on your organization's priorities too, on if you're trying to help everybody who shows up, or if you're trying to get the people out of line that can help themselves, and save the line time for those who might need more assistance. So when there's a field like, you know, tell me why you're using this form, or tell me what happened, I will build in the ability to have overflow, because I don't want to limit someone's narrative or someone's explanation to the judge, whatever. But if there are limiters that would make it very complicated to keep to automate or to keep updated after the fact, like numerous repeat loops for children, or having to build out custom addendums that then have to be updated or translated, I might limit the interview to the form itself. So I've done both.
And Eric is asking a question I think is directed at what you're saying, Jessica, which is, would you spell that out? Where do you spell out the limitations? Is it in instructions external to the interview or in the interview itself?
I would have it on both. So I would have it at the point on your website in which you're going to provide the link to the interview. So I would have it, you know, a quick little bullet point of like, who should use this interview? You know, people in this jurisdiction who meet this income qualification, if there is one, whatever your qualification questions or disqualifications are going to be, I would put that there. And then I would for sure put it into the interview, and you can build it into the logic of your interview. So like in A to J, we always talk about the beginning screens should have instructions. And first off, you should introduce the form to the people, you know, explain what they're going to get out of sitting through an interview, like tell them what their end goal is going to be. So at the end of this interview, you will have all the paperwork you need to complete X. And then you should explain how long it's going to take. So roughly this is going to take you 30 to 60 minutes. And then you should have a list of all, like a checklist of all the items they're going to need. So you're going to need to know your children's school address, your ex-husband's social security number, your W-2s, anything that people wouldn't readily know off the top of their head. Create sort of a checklist so that if they want to leave and come back with that information, they have it. I always, when I'm doing it, picture someone in my head who's like sitting on a bus trying to fill this out on their phone, and they're like, they get halfway through it and they're like, oh crap, I didn't know I needed, you know, my W-2 from last year. I don't have access to that on my phone right now. It's in a filing cabinet in my bedroom. Or someone at a library who, like, what would they have in their purse or their, like, their pocket within their driver's license, you know, their wallet, that kind of stuff. And what are they not going to have on hand with them? And I always put that in the checklist. And then I walk through the qualification question. So do they have to be 18? I ask them their birth date, and I do logic to test if they're 18 or not. What's your address? And then if there's any restrictions based on where their address is, that kicks them out. And then any of these, like, do you have more than four children? Anything that's going to kick someone out of an interview, I want them out of the interview before they spend more than 10 minutes going through it. So I always put the qualification questions in the beginning before we get into any meat of the interview, because I want all the people who aren't supposed to be there gone before they spend any real amount of time investing in the process, because that's just going to frustrate them if they get halfway through and then get kicked out for some reason. So it's always in the beginning.
And I think Jessica's point is a very good one. You do not want to get people, you know, get people an hour into the interview and then find out you can't use this. And it is important, very important to do qualification up front. I will say that I've done PDF templates for courts, and they have a very different take on the, you know, kicking people out. They will kick people out on, you know, if it's an unusual situation, if the rules of the law make it really, really complicated and they really should talk to a lawyer, for example. But things like the number of children, they generally will not tolerate a limitation. But that's courts, because obviously they're trying to serve a broad swath of the public and want to make it as, you know, useful as possible for their users.
I wanted to add something about PDFs that has to do with Apple users. For people that are on mobile iPhones or tablets, you need to make sure that you give them some notes on how to open the PDF on those devices, because some of our users run into problems with that. And they may need to install software on the device to be able to open the PDF, or they may need to go to a different device that is not running, you know, that is not on an Apple tool to open it. And so, you know, a lot of people get frustrated because they can open the PDF, but that's completely independent of LHI. There's always been a lack of congruity between PDF, Adobe, and the Apple products. So I encourage you, if you're going to, you know, and you know, the use of Apple devices is continues to grow, right? And so you may want to have some notes, you know, to let people know that if they cannot open it on an Apple, to try to open it on a different, on a laptop or something like that. Because it does, we catch those users because we do provide backend support and we catch them, but we are not able to, you know, because there's so many different types of device. I mean, a lot of, you know, we have people that are still like on Galaxy 7s or whatever, Samsung 7, you know, 7, all the way to the most cutting edge. And so we're not able to let every single person know exactly how to upgrade their phone to pull the PDF open. So just making a note so that you can be aware of that, because when it comes to you, just know that it's not LHI. There's nothing we can do about that because it's on the device. And same thing with word processing, right? They need to have the correct word processing, because if they're using, a lot of people try to use Wordtex, and what ends up happening is that everything is misformatted. What comes out at the end is a misformatted document. And then those that have the attachments, like we were talking about before, those get really crazy, like they come really crazy. So they need to, users need to make sure that they have, you know, the right type of word processing on their device. And this is neutral Apple and non-Apple, so that when they pull the document open in their device, it's pulling the right sort of word processing program.
So other questions about either the introduction to A2J or PDF templates? I think if there are no more questions, we can close out for today, and folks can do their hot dogs homework for next week. Now we're going to get into some more interesting aspects of hot dogs and stuff that's a little bit more challenging. Start to see the real power of it. So, last chance for anybody to chip in if they have something they'd like to raise. So, Claudia, do you have any final parting words?
No, I'm good. No final parting words. In a little bit, I hope all of you have signed up to the list, because we're going to be doing one last training call, bringing kind of capacity creation call sometime before December 15th. So I'll be posting for a list on that topic. And we generally try to close the year with a really good kind of software neutral type conversation about document assembly, etc. So make sure that you're on the list so that you can get those announcements. But nothing more here.
Okay, great. Thank you, everyone. Resume next week.
Bye.
Thanks, bye.